Pujan, we are live now. You can start.
So welcome everyone to the Dolphin Tank Series A event, where 25 NGOs would be pitching to scale their work across 5 tanks today. This is our 4th tank for the day. The format of the event will have Living My Promise signatories as dolphins who have in principle agreed to support these organizations. Dolphins are wiser and kinder than sharks, hence this name. I would also use this opportunity to talk about Living My Promise. Living My Promise is a community of like-minded Indians who have committed to giving 50% or more of their wealth to philanthropies, either during their lifetime or in their will. Promises help each other and also invite other advantaged people to make this promise. Anyone with a net worth of over 1 CR can make this promise. The causes, the organizations, and the activities that you support are entirely your choice. To know more about this initiative, you can visit www.livingmypromise.in. The organizations pitching today have also set up crowdfunding links, the links for which are also shared in the comment section of Living My Promise Facebook page. So the audience watching us today can also support the organizations if their work impresses you. So quick introduction to our friendly dolphins today. First up, we have Arshna and Hari. Arshna currently volunteers on multiple community projects in an effort to learn ground realities from people. She earlier worked in GiveIndia as a head for online giving subscriptions and workplace giving, helping hundreds of nonprofit to meet their fundraising goals. Hari Shamsundar is VP and Senior Research Analyst at Franklin Templeton Investments. We also have Mr. Upendra Bhatt with us today. He's a go-to-market and techno-commercial specialist with expertise in technology evaluation and linkages. We have Fiona and Lewis also joining us. Fiona is the director of Seeds of Awareness and 17,000 Foundation. Lewis is the chairman of CORO and Center of Civil Society. He is the chairman and co-founder at Indian School of Public Policy and mentor to many non-profit organizations. We also have Sridhar with us. Sridhar Sethuram is a private equity investor and an impact evangelist. So we can start with the event, and the participants will have exactly 3 minutes to pitch, after which they'll be asked to stop. 5 minutes for the question and answers questions from the dolphins, and we'll have 2 minutes to seal it. So all the best to all the participants. First up on our list is Manzil Mystics. Yes, our Manzil Mystics.
Thank you so much, Kunjan. Can I share my screen?
Yes, please.
It is disabled from the host.
I have enabled it.
Yes, thank you. Let me know when can I start.
You can start now.
Yeah. Thank you so much, everyone. My name is Anurag.
You can start now.
Hi everyone, my name is Anurag. I come from a Delhi-based music choir and a non-profit called Manzil Mystics. I'm a Delhi government student, studying in a Delhi government school, but come from a magical place called Manzil, started by an IIM Ahmedabad graduate, Ravi Gulati. At Manzil Mystics, we are just trying to increase the accessibility and usability of music in education. So there are approximately 4.2 million children studying in Delhi, low-income and government schools in Delhi, and 80% of them do not have any access to music education. And 100% of them do not have any basic infrastructure in place. As a person, as an organization, I believe that every child deserves at least 1 hour of music education in a week so that they can realize their fullest potential. We teach the children how to sing, write, and compose a song, but we design our activities in a way that we cover educational skills and policies through music. In addition to this, we have built India's first mobile music classroom and a recording studio to solve the infrastructure problem and home deliver the best quality music education we can. The Learning Through Music Fellowship that you can see down there is a well-rounded fellowship, specially designed for musicians come from low-income background. And various funding sources have made the delivery of the program possible in a very new way. 100% of our employees have studied in a government school and are musicians. that makes us unique. And we give back to community by building a strong connect. Maybe because of this, Delhi government has collaborated with us as a knowledge partner to run their two new schools in performing and visual arts and give us permission to work in 1,030 schools this year. And what has it impacted? Like, we have built happy and safe spaces for 3 lakh children in 4 states and sustainable career for 50 plus musicians so far in last 4 years. And the request we have is we are raising 14 lakh rupees for next 3 months and to convey the happiness and hope of the children. 1 to 5 lakh rupees to performing and visual arts school the Delhi government has started and create a music in education curriculum for 1,030 students, government students. 5 lakh rupees for the currently that we're working with 3,000 children and 4 lakh rupees for the music fellowship that I was talking about. And at last, you can gift a music performance if you want. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anurag. For our viewers, quickly, before we get into the questions from the Dolphins, you can also support Panzil Mystics through the crowdfunding campaign, which is shared on our Facebook page. We can start with the questions.
So Anurag, this is Lewis here. Why is it important to teach kids music, in your view? What's the big deal about music?
I guess, for me personally, I got 52% in 12th grade and I didn't get any admission in school. And that was the reason why I went to Manzil. And I end up getting 100% scholarship to study in the US and topping my classroom for MSW I did. And this is the story for all the members. So music does something in yourself. And this was so personal, that's why we started. Later on, we realized that National Curriculum Framework or new education policy, everyone has talked about the importance of music in education because it's not only about learning music, it is about learning through music. Yeah, thank you.
I have a question from Fiona.
Yes. Can I ask the question?
Yes, Fiona.
Hi, lovely. I love the fact that you are bringing music to children. Just want to know how did the children practice on the instruments or practice instruments? Because when you play and you're learning an instrument, you need a lot of practice, like daily practice kind of thing. So how do the kids actually practice then? You know, if they're from low income families, I doubt they can afford instruments in their homes. So how do you all go about that?
So majorly, since last 4 years, we are focusing more on singing, writing, and composing. And we also teach audio production, graphic designing, and all that. But we do teach guitar. And the only thing the child has to have is the guitar. They have to have it. And if they cannot afford it, we help them in to buy it. But I guess majorly, we're not doing instruments.
Okay.
That's why we're focusing more on vocal because it is learning music, as I said earlier, but it is learning through music. We're connecting education policies and skills through music. But people who can afford these basic instruments, I'll just show you. This is ukulele that we teach. And this costs like 2,000 rupees, right? And children can afford it if they want. And we are teaching something like this in mental health. Thanks,
Diana. Okay. Thank you.
Arshana has a question.
Thanks, Kunji. Hi, Anurag. I actually have a couple of questions. So one of them is the definitely music. To learn music itself is a wonderful thing for the children per se. What I would do want to understand is you had said learning through music and not learning music. So I do want to understand how it is that you're looking at building the skills among the students. The art itself being a right brain lens of it, how do you kind of balance it out? Like to some extent, I am a little more left brain than the right brain. I'm not so great at music. So how do you kind of balance it out for you to be addressing all the students out there? Or is it a limited number of students that you work with within the school system itself? So that's one thing that I just wanted to understand, the fundamentals of what you're bringing to the students. The second is it complementary to what is being done in the school, or is it part of the school curriculum itself that you're able to work within the school's, you know, the school's education framework itself that you're taking it to the children?
Yeah. So the first question is, we don't select children, we work with all the children, because I'll just tell you one example, that one policy that we're covering, the Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, reading, writing, comprehension. So you can only perform on stage if you know how to sing, say, write, and explain the song. That's what we do, and then that's how we design it. But I'll just talk about a policy. It's called Kishori Manch, in which every girl has to know about menstrual hygiene and reproductive health. And we have designed it in a 4-month long comprehensive program called Vibhor. Just when we talk about menstrual cycle, reproductive health, and gender education. Where the girls write about the song. So we have a song on menstrual cycle. You can go on YouTube and check it out. And so the conversations and the music are weaved in a way that they cover and they understand all these topics. So likewise, history, math, and all that. So it is less about, every child can write. If you cannot sing, you can write. If you cannot write, you can tap the flow. If you cannot do that, you can compose. There are some talent in every child that we believe they have it. The second question was about, did I answer your second question?
To an extent, yes. The second one was more about how you work within the school's operations itself. Is it part of the curriculum? Is it complementary? Or is it outside of what the government school's operations are?
So currently, government do not have the curriculum. That's what we're building, and that's what the request was about. The government has just started School of Specialized Excellence, and there are 2 performing and visual arts schools, and Mandal Mystics is the partner. So we just built a fresh curriculum. It's a music curriculum, but they're more instruction and curriculum framework based. The school just tell us ki we want to cover history or this topic or that topic, that skill. And we just do it through music. It can also be the sanitary or hand washing habits. That's it. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Anurag. I think we have overshot the time for the questions.
Yes.
If there are any questions, probably we can have it maybe at the end. So the viewers watching, if you like this pitch and the work that they are doing, you can also fund them through the crowdfunding link. Can we now have the support from the Dolphins or Mansur Mystics?
So shall I go
first?
Archana is asking a question, but I can go first.
Yes.
Somebody's asked a question of among the dolphins. I am on a laptop.
Yeah, no. I just want to know how this works among the dolphin.
Yeah, so anybody, any one of you wishes to support can announce that how much you are wishing to support or what kind of support you are extending to the organization. So,
okay. Sridhar, do you want to go?
Yeah, so I will go. This is in behalf of Ujjwal Impact Advisors, not only me. So I go with 2.5 lakhs guaranteed. And with every 1 lakh that gets generated more, I'll match that up to a max of 5 lakhs.
Thank you, Shreya.
So matching donation for every 1 lakh or every 50,000 that gets donated today. With a base of 2.5 lakhs and above that, I'll match everybody. We will match everybody.
Okay, can I go next?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Really appreciate what you're doing with kids. I'm a musician myself and I see the importance. And happy to support you guys with 2 lakhs.
So much, Shana.
Yeah, can I go next? Or
yes. Yes.
Sorry,
please.
I missed part of what you were presenting, Anurag, but I had taken a look at the deck. I have a few follow-up questions which I can take offline, but would commit 2 lakhs for now.
Thank you so much, Appendant.
Thank you. I think anybody else wants to go or can you participate? Thank you, Anurag. Thank you, Anurag, for joining us.
Just to Gunjan confirm, this will be 5 lakhs from me. So 5 plus 2 plus 2 is 7, 9. 9 from this forum.
Thank you. Thank you, Sridhar. Thank you. Thank you for Ujjwal. Thank you, Anurag. And all the best.
I can leave now, right?
Yes, please.
And Anurag, Fiona would like to connect with you later to just talk about it some more. So, Gunjan, if you can just help us connect with Anurag.
Sure, I will.
Yeah. Great job.
Bye-bye.
Thanks. Thank you.
So the next organization that we have is the Resilient Foundation. Is Resilient Foundation ready with their presentation?
They're still joining, it's not connecting. I'm admitting them that it's saying that they're still joining.
They're there.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are. Can you share your screen?
Yes, I'm sharing my screen. Let me know if when it is visible. Yeah, can I start?
Yes, one second. Yes, please, you can start.
Okay, hello everyone. I am Bhupendra from the Resilient Foundation, and I'm here with the cause to build a disaster resilient community through prevention and preparedness measures. Can you remember an incident where you lost near ones in tragic accident or in emergency situation, medical emergency situation? 16 years ago, I met with an accident. I fell from a roof. I was bleeding heavily. Everyone thought I was dead, but I was fortunate enough to receive medical treatment on time. My elder sister hospitalized me and she saved my life. But this is not the case every time. We know millions of people are dying in various accidents. In 2019 itself, we witnessed a tragic incident in Surat coaching class where 22 students died because of the fire. And there are many such incidents happening around the globe and in and around the country. We can save 80% of these people by just acting as a first responder, and there is a problem. We don't even know how to respond to an emergency situation. And here we felt a need to start a nonprofit organization, and we started in 2018. Till date, we have trained around 5,000 people in 77 plus institutions in Uttarakhand, Maharashtra, and Delhi. A few days back, I received a text message from one of my friends, and she thanked me and she said, Bhupendra, thank you for inviting me in your workshop. Due to that, I was able to save someone in my family today. That was a case of heart attack. She applied CPR, learned in the program. And this is what we do. We are preparing individuals, communities, so that they can handle their own emergency and we can save more and more people. Currently, we are working on a Mrityunjay Dut initiative with Maharashtra Police. We are aiming to train 3,000 police and 5,000 community people across national highways of Maharashtra. We are also working in 104 tribal ashram schools and aiming to train 4,000 first responders in all the villages and in the schools. Here, we are also reducing the risk of the school by mapping and retrofitting of the hazards in and around the schools. This is our team where me and Rajan and Abhidna from disaster management background and Yugandhara and Punama from corporate background. And we are supported by part-timers, associates, and many volunteers in the team. Hence, we are looking for 29 lakh rupees of funds to cover cost of our ground operation and some amount to unrestricted amount for to develop some verticals inside the organization. And I hope you will support us to step ahead us in the journey. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have, yes, we can have the questions for the
Hi, Bhupendra, this is Hari here. I wanted to understand, I wanted to understand. Thanks for the deck. I mean, the talk is very interesting and it appeals pretty directly. I just wanted to understand what exactly are you teaching, and is it like first aid, which you are first aid classes which you are doing, and what are the audience? Could you give some idea about what kind of reach you've got?
So we are working in multi-hazard approach. Along with first aid, we also conduct program on first aid, fire safety, and search and rescue. This is all incorporated there. Also, we are working on flood rescue and what to do in the time of earthquake and all. So basically, we are starting with schools. We have started with schools working in tribal schools of Palghar, where we are not just delivering a training program. We are also mapping and retrofitting hazards in and nearby the school so that we can reduce the risk before the disasters. And with Maharashtra Police, we are just providing a basic life support training where they have already appointed 5,000 people across the national highway. And these trainings incorporate all first aid, search and rescue, and other techniques of rope, how to make a knots and all. So these are the program we conduct. Yeah.
Thank you, Bhupendra.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions that call any students ask? So. Sure. We have one more questions that I'll also ask audience. To support the organization, if you like the work that they're doing, through the crowdfunding link that is already shared on our Facebook page. Sure. Now, could
I go with a question?
Yes, please.
In one of your slides, which I'd seen before, you had mentioned about some school disaster management training and plans. What exactly does that entail?
And, so basically, yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
So there is, please. Okay, so there are lots of guidelines around the school disaster management plan given by the government, NDMA, National Disaster Management Authority, and then some of the guidelines are by the international agencies like UNICEF, UNESCO, and so on. So we are currently mapping, we are mapping hazards and vulnerability of the schools. We are retrofitting them. We are creating disaster management profiles, building committees and task force, and training them, and continuing with the mock drills, and also that. We can provide holistic solution rather than giving just a training. To give one example of this, if you will learn how to operate a fire extinguisher and you will land somewhere and you don't find any fire extinguisher, or the fire extinguisher doesn't operate, that doesn't make any sense. So you need to have a holistic approach where the system should be in place and you should know how to operate hydrant and fire systems like that. So like we have end-to-end solution for the entire disaster management, prevention and preparedness.
I think we have much time for the questions. So can we move to the support for the organization?
Yeah, hi, Archana and Hari here. Bhupendra, I think the work which your organization is doing is very important. It's one of those things which you realize the importance only once the disasters hit you, and that knowledge you wish you had known earlier, or you appreciate the knowledge which you have learned earlier. And I personally can speak for that. And so we would like to support the organization with 2 lakhs.
Thank you, Archana. Thank you for your support.
Any other support? So the viewers watching us, if you want to support, you can support the organizations with the crowdfunding just shared on our Facebook page. Thank you, Resilient, for joining us today. So much, and all the best.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Who wants to say something? Sure. So the next organization that we have for the day is Daksha's Foundation. You can start now.
Thank you for taking this time to review our work at Meditoris, the Daksha's pro bono clinical platform to unlock efficiency and unused healthcare capacity. We incubated as a solution at Encore and scaled using the support of Tata Trust. Now we are converting this Meditoris into a platform through pro bono tech partners like Virtusa and are incubating at Unlimited India and Unleash. We work through nonprofit healthcare collaboratives like COVID Action Collab, CoLive, and Catalyst 2030. Let me share a story with you how Meditoris changes the healthcare system. Here is an abandoned elderly who was a dog bite victim. So street dogs had taken a chunk of her flesh. Once Meditoris was roped into this, she found a clinic where she received first aid and primary care, was escalated to a hospital, operated, and rehabilitated into an old age home. So Dakshas is able to tap into the capacity of other healthcare stakeholders by aggregating all their non-core activities. On our platform, Meditoris, we also embed specialist protocols. So we are able to aggregate their core activities. So the evaluation that a nurse does is so relevant that general physicians can then release 90% of the prescriptions on basis of that evaluation. And specialists save 80% of their time, which they then give back for procedures like that happened in this lady's case. We've run these platforms as a project for 24 months. We've treated 43,000 patients, delivering 120,000 treatment sessions and 220 surgeries at a cost average cost of 16% of the private healthcare cost. And what we have seen is that thorough first evaluations lead to downstream effects and reduce the cost of healthcare delivery throughout the cycle. Now we want to convert Dakshas into a platform. We are growing this by sharing it with nonprofit ecosystems that I mentioned, and we hope to integrate public health, clinical medicine, and hospitalized care into one single stream by integrating the evaluation and treatment decisions that are taken. We also offer these collaboratives other healthcare tools like healthcare readiness dashboards and rural healthcare logistics platforms. This is our team. I'm an orthopedic surgeon. Nidhi manages our primary care team. Professor Padmavati advises us on networks, Mr. Srinagesh on business, and Charan from SmartBots is our technology advisor. Our current ask is bridge fund so that we can get through this year till April next, because a lot of funding has otherwise been tied up in COVID relief and COVID rehabilitation, and we're finding a scarcity of funding for planned healthcare delivery. We plan to use this funding to run a model healthcare service in Hyderabad and onboard other nonprofits onto Meditoris so that medical practitioners all over can deliver similar care. Thank you.
Thank you. So we can have the questions from the...
Bharat, can you enable your camera?
Can I go first?
Yes.
Hey, Bharat, lovely space to be in. Who's your primary target segment? I noticed you've done about 1 lakh customers. What would be their profile like?
So our primary target segment is anybody with a white ration card, elderly above 60 years, migrant populations who do not have documentation, and healthcare workers. But the field staff is empowered to deem anybody as a person who needs help and unlock the system for them.
And other than funds, what would your big challenges be at the moment?
We are trying to tap into unused technology.
You're on mute.
Sorry, can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can.
Yeah, yes, we can. Yeah.
Okay, so we are also trying to convince technology companies to participate with us in their incubation, in their training programs. You know, when they induct new engineers, they undergo a training program to how to use technology for first 6 months. So we're trying to talk to technology companies to give that 6 months to nonprofits to help us develop pro bono health tech faster. So we have a health tech project for which we are looking at for a potential technology partner.
So I have a question, Bharat. It's again, fascinating work you guys are doing. Why do you require only 8 lakhs? What's this for? I mean, I saw you give a breakup over there, but I'm trying to understand what is this 8 lakhs going for? And how
are it? Okay, so our cost of running a program is around 14 to 21 lakhs a year. And we are looking for funding to help us sustain till next March. to help sustain this program till next March. So this 8 lakhs would help us to run a model service in Hyderabad and also onboard other healthcare nonprofits onto this platform so that we can scale its implementation. And that's the amount we require.
Any more questions?
I heard you mention about this partnership that you're trying to inspire amongst the tech companies to dedicate young professionals. If that doesn't pan out over the next couple of years, how do you see your tech platform evolving? Would you continue to be in this base pre-alpha state, or what exactly is the plan with the whole initiative?
So there are two strategies here. We've been partnering with tech companies from 2019. And we see that the first 6 months when their inductees come in and they run these training programs, the inductees are available to take live projects from NGOs. And we have been able to inspire 3 tech companies to participate and develop tech platforms for us on a pro bono basis. In fact, during the second wave, we have developed 4 tech platforms. We are talking to other tech companies to give us that first 6 months of their incubators. The second plan would be that we can license our existing platforms to the for-profit space and use that funding to develop the rest of the tech platforms that we need. So these are the 2 ways we would try to mitigate it. The purpose here is to not incur fixed cost, because it is fixed cost that makes healthcare unaffordable. So we're trying to every which way to get around incurring any fixed cost.
I'm afraid we don't have time for more questions, but do we have any questions? Thank you. So the viewers listening, you've heard Bharat's pitch and the question answers. If you're willing to support the organization, you can do so by the crowdfunding link, which is shared in our the comment section of our Facebook page, which is livingmypromise.com/Facebook. Now we can move to the support for the questions. Anyone can ask.
Okay, Fiona and I well done, Bharat. I think Fiona and I think this is a good space. We'd like to give you 2 lakhs.
Thank you so much, Luis. That would be amazing support. Thank you.
Gunjan, I would like to pledge 2 lakhs as well.
Thank you, Upendra. That's amazing support.
I think this is an initiative, a good initiative if you can keep this going.
Oh, yes. I think with support such as yours, we definitely see it reach its conclusion.
Thank you, Dolphins. And
I was waiting for if there were any many more volunteer pledges.
Sure, go ahead.
I am willing to pledge time on this. So if you can give mine and Ujjwal's contacts to Bharat, lovely work that he is doing. We will try to do our best in giving him whatever he wants to achieve his dream.
Yes, we appreciate that immensely, because expertise contributed has one of the most amazing impacts in nonprofit space. So thank you for that.
Yeah, so both Ujjwal and I will be in touch to help Louis and others ensure that the money, every penny is well worth.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dolphins, and thank you, Bharat. So thank you so much and all the best.
Have a good afternoon. Bye.
Bye.
Well done. The next is Prayas, right?
So next up we have Prayas from Tata Institute of Social Sciences.
Professor Raghavan, are you there?
Yes.
Yes. So can you share your screen and
Yes. Okay. Should I start?
Thank you. Yes, you can start.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you for this opportunity to speak about the work that we are doing. I represent Prayas. I'm a co-founder which is a field action project of the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, which has been working with persons affected by criminalization or victimization in the criminal justice system for the last more than 31 years. If you look at the reason why we are working in this space, more than 4.5 lakh prisoners are processed at any given point of time. 70% of them are under trials, around 5% are women. Thousands of persons get trafficked every year. Most of them are women and children. And the question that should rankle in our minds is, what happens to a woman when she gets released from prison or when she's rescued by the police from commercial sex? This is one of the main reasons why we are working in this space. The fact that we are working with these women is that they come from very marginalized backgrounds, most of them from Dalits and tribals, and from broken families, often with a history of violence, and continue to bear the stigma of the burden of stigma and labeling and discrimination, even after they get released. Prayas works basically towards the legal rights and rehabilitation of institutional populations like prisoners, released prisoners, women rescued from commercial sex, children in conflict with law, etc. If you look at our impact over the last 31 years, we have reached out to more than 42,000 individuals and their families through our socio-legal and rehabilitative intervention services. We are currently working in 8 prisons and 3 custodial institutions. We've been associated in more than 10 landmark judgments in the Supreme Court and in the Bombay High Court through public interest. Some of the examples of the advocacy work that we have done is that the grant for released prisoners in Maharashtra, which used to be 5,000, has been increased to 25,000 per prisoner. And the annual budget under the scheme has increased from 12 lakhs to 1 crore per annum, which means that earlier only about 50 prisoners were getting benefit of the scheme. Now more than 400 prisoners are getting benefit under the scheme. Detailed guidelines have been issued for the rehabilitation of women living in shelter homes and for children living in prison with their mothers as a result of Prayas's advocacy efforts. Many of our clients are now getting benefit of government schemes like Jan Dhan Yojana account, Sanjay Gandhi Niradhar Yojana, Ghar Kul Yojana, and the recent COVID relief schemes, including a scheme which was specially designed for women coming out of commercial sex at the rate of 5,000 rupees per month. Many of the women have been helped to get a benefit of these schemes. Where will the contribution that you give go to? It will go towards program expenses and personal costs to strengthen our post-release rehabilitation work. Thank you.
So much. We can start with the questions from the participants, please. So if you don't need the screen, you can stop sharing.
Yeah, I don't need the screen.
Professor, I think this is fabulous work, with something which, we talk about, but I don't think gets done much. Could you just walk us through an example of how you rehabilitate a woman? What are the process?
Yes. So firstly, our social workers work inside custody, whether it is the prison or it is the shelter home for women. Essentially, it could be a rescue home for women rescued from commercial sex, or it could be a shelter home for women in distress, or a women's section in a jail. We have a team of social workers and legal fellows who go inside these institutions on a regular basis, and they start identifying cases of women who need help. The range could be women who need legal aid, women who might need support with their families, support with their children left outside, contacting their families, attending to their health issues. By attending to these series of services that we arrange, we develop a relationship with the person. And then on that basis, some of them would come to us and say, I need help when I get out of the institution. And that is where our post-institutional work starts. And when the woman gets released from the institution, then again, the second set of our work starts, which starts from providing emergency assistance in terms of shelter, because some of them don't have family support. It could mean paying house rent for a few months till they are up on their feet. It would involve vocational training and livelihood capacity building. It would include educational expenses of their children and attending to their medical emergencies. And over a period of time, they would then start getting settled down in their life. We also have a specially designed rehabilitation program for our women, which is known as the NGO placement program, whereby we place our clients, women clients, in the NGO sector towards relearning of social skills and vocational skills. Many of these women today have become social workers, health workers, nursing assistants, Balwadi teachers. And so basically they are becoming productive citizens within the social space, which is also helping them to counter the social stigma and labeling which many women in this space face.
Any other question?
How much would be your total budget, Prof?
So our since we work in many, many institutions, our overall budget is about 7.4 crores. But we right now have a 15% shortfall in our overall budget. We have a team of 55 plus people who are working across 6 districts in Maharashtra and Gujarat.
We have time for 2 more questions. So if anyone wants to, maybe one, yeah. Can I have one more question?
Yeah, so just a very quick thing. When we see Maharashtra and Gujarat, are there specific locations that you
yes.
work in?
Yes, so currently we are working in Mumbai, Thane, Navi Mumbai, Latur, Solapur to some extent, Bharuch and Narmada districts. And we are currently working in 8 prisons and 3 shelter homes for women and children.
Fiona has a question. So
Fabulous work. Really, really impressed.
Thank you.
And just want to ask you, women and children who are in these, have been subjugated to these kind of conditions require a lot of counseling. And
yes.
It's not a one-time counseling.
Absolutely,
It has to go on. So
yes.
what are the measures that you guys take to kind of continue
yes.
with them
yes.
over a period of time?
Yes, ma'am. It's a very good question because some of our clients whom we call as clients in social work jargon, we are in touch with them over decades because
okay.
they need that kind of support and help. The direct assistance may stop within a year or so, but the indirect assistance in terms of emotional support, moral support, in terms of counseling, that continues for long. In fact, during the COVID period, we had many of our clients, hundreds of them, in fact, getting in touch with us, even though they were well settled, we had assumed, because of the COVID situation, they lost their jobs and livelihoods. And we had to immediately reach out to them with dry ration support and other kinds of help that we had to give them, including cash transfers. So one message that we give out to all our clients is, if you are in need, please do not hesitate to get in touch with us because we do not have a closed door policy. We have an open door policy with the women that we work with.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So before we get into the support from the dolphins, for our viewers who are watching Prayas pitch here and the work that they're doing, they can support the organization through the crowdfunding link to our Facebook page. Now we like the dolphins to tell us what they would like to support. Fiona has raised her hand.
Okay, this is on behalf of Fiona and I. Professor, we'd like to give you 2.5. We're getting inspired by Sridhar. So we'll do 2.5. And if anyone else puts up, we'll put in another matching 2.5.
Thank you so much.
And also, I'm with an organization which is in your backyard called Koro.
Oh, yes, of course.
I chaired that. And we'd like to see how we can actually work with
sure.
some sort of victims that you
sure.
sort of work with. And we help
sure.
them in the NGO
yes.
space.
Yeah, I know Sujata very well.
Yes, she's a fabulous person.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Anyone else?
I will go with Lewis and commit 1 and also time. Also would connect you to an organization called Missing Saving Girls.
Okay.
Founded by Leena Kejriwal. She's doing some amazing work in prevention of sex trafficking.
Sridhar, your voice is very faint. Can you? Can everybody hear clearly? As in, his voice is faint.
I can hear.
We heard the 1 lakh here. That was important.
Yeah.
At the time.
That's all that is important. Everything else. and really heart-wrenching what you do. So hats off.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So it's lovely to see you.
Thank you.
Just want to add, Professor, that I work with an organization called Seas of Awareness, and we work in collaboration with TIS, a certified course in comprehensive sexual education and facilitation. And I would love to connect with you and see whether we can do anything to build capacity
for your workers. Most happy. I'll get in touch with you. I'll get your email contact through
Sushant. Absolutely. Happy to.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Awesome work. I think that Prayas is doing. We'll commit 1.5.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you so much. Thank you all of you for giving me this opportunity. I think this has been the fastest time within which we've been able to raise about 5 lakhs.
Technically now it's because of Upendra and Sridhar, we'll give 5, so you get 7.5.
Thank you so much.
Well done.
Thank you.
And all the best.
Thank you.
Our viewers watching can help through the crowdfunding link too.
Can we just add in here?
Yes.
So there's also the crowdfunding that's happening with this live streaming. If you're not able to reach the goal, whatever the budget is, we will chip in after 10 days. If the goal is not still reached, then we will contribute up to 1.5 lakhs.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sushant and Gunjan, for this opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah. I can leave now, right?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks.
So the last organization in the tank is Nature Mates. Can we have your presentation, please? You can start.
So, good afternoon, all the participants. We are Nature Mates. We are teaching here for our ecological restoration program in Sundarban landscape. So, this is a landscape where, you know,
Your voice is sounding a little muffled.
Hello. Audible now? Hello.
It's still a little muffled.
I think the audio has some problem. It's muffled. It's not very clear.
So, hello. Is it better now?
Not really.
It's the same.
Gunjan, otherwise, do you want to run the slide yourself from your end and let him just speak without the video? Will that maybe help? Is that possible?
I can stop the video and check.
No, but then we
Louis, that won't make any difference. I think the problem is with the system.
The microphone, I think.
Yeah, it could be the Bluetooth device or the the speaker that you've connected to. That causes a disruption usually.
With earphones, I'm able to hear properly. So just try earphones. Maybe sometimes that also happens.
Okay, fine. An issue. Okay.
Yeah. Hello. Am I audible now?
It still is the same. If you don't have an alternative, I think, can we go ahead as is?
Let's go ahead.
Okay. So it's a place for 100 tigers and 5 million people. And it's a very fragile ecosystem right now. And the environmental situation is also, degrading. So with this effort, with this initiative, we are hello?
Can you try maybe without the microphone? Can anybody hear him?
No.
Not able to hear clearly. Could you try without the earphones, please?
Try without the earphones. I think that should work.
Hello.
Yep.
Hello.
Yeah, now we can hear you pretty well.
Am I audible?
Yeah, much better.
Yes, I think this is better. You can start.
Arjun, much better. Why don't you get started?
I think he has some problem.
Why don't we give him a chance to just re-log back on? We're going to try that. As you can see, I'm technologically challenged. It's just someone has a smarter idea.
I think we should give him a fair chance. So
yes, exactly. Yeah, that's right.
Can wait.
Yeah. Yeah, but he can log off and log back on again. Maybe try that.
Sushant, chat with him on WhatsApp, obviously.
I'm already doing it.
Hello.
Have any, while we're waiting for that, have any of you guys been to the Sundarbans?
Yes, who has been?
Yeah. Can you hear us?
I have.
Hello.
Sushant, or is it?
Hi.
Is that Nature's Mate trying to reach out?
I'm trying to call him. He's not taking my call. Just
maybe he's out of connectivity.
To this answer your question,
hello.
To answer your question, Lewis, I've been on the Bangladesh side.
Hello.
Oh, it's
heart-wrenching. It's a heart-wrenching, heart-wrenching.
Of course, that will be expected from Sri Lanka.
This is very Lewis, who is gone.
These things don't surprise us anymore, Sri.
It's heart-wrenching to get there. It's totally bad.
Yeah.
Okay.
He will log out and log in. Just give it to me. Sorry.
Sure.
So who said he's seen it from the Bangladesh side? Was it Sridhar, you, or was it okay. Sridhar, where have you not gone to yet?
Hey, space.
you're the, who are you going with? Elon Musk, or you're going with Bezos?
When they reduce the price, I will go.
Sridhar, you have to come to Sikkim now. I've just finished with it, and it's awesome. Yeah, you just have to come here.
Yeah, it's lovely. I was there in 92, actually, one of the first Indians to get a permit to go in there. So it must have changed a lot, but it's so beautiful country. So Sujata was telling in the morning.
Yeah. The remote villages are just something else.
Super. Hello.
Crazy.
Am I audible now?
Yes, it's better.
Let's go with it, whatever it is. So we'll feel good.
Okay.
Go with it, Share your screen.
Extremely sorry for this. Hello. So Sundarban is an ecologically very special landscape with tigers and, with 5 billion people. So, and the landscape is, is extremely exploited by people because so many people living there. And we are now with this project trying to minimize that anthropogenic pressure on Sundarban by providing them alternative livelihood and by providing them food security, not in form of food packets, but in form of plants, which they will grow at their pace and they will have food security over the period of time. It's not a one-time support type thing. So what are the support? We have two verticals. One is to provide, nutritional support in form of a stack of 5 trees and some vegetable seeds. And also, we will be restoring their ponds, which are destroyed during the Amphan and Jash and other cyclones. That pond will help them with freshwater supply, and also that pond will be used for pisciculture, where they can earn money out of it. In the landscape vertical, we will be doing a mangrove plantation comprising of 20,000 mangrove plants, and this mangrove plantation will act as a barrier against this cyclone. Also, it will help in saving the embankments, which are a major problem during these cyclones, through which the salt water gets inside the villages. So, what we have done in this landscape, we are working in Sundarban landscape since, last 20-25 years, but we are mostly working there with the non-human entities so far. During the recent years, we have taken an approach of landscape initiative where we are supporting people by providing them training, by providing awareness and, you know, health benefits, etc. So overall, we have around 15,000 plus beneficiaries so far in Sundarban. We have planted 20,000 plus mangroves already, and we have already planted 8,000 plus fruit trees, which are already put in some cases. To do this work, we have a very good team, experienced team, who have experience in working in Sundarban with local people included. And we are guided by two very eminent personalities, Jerry Alistair and Professor Nidhanesh, who are, who have immense experience from the Sundarban landscape. So what we are looking for a total budget of 20 lakh rupees. Out of that, 10 lakh will be spent for mangrove plantation and monitoring, 4.3 lakh will be spent for pond restoration, 3.75 lakh will be spent for fruit tree plantation, and 1.95 lakh will be spent for vegetable gardening and vegetable seed distribution and gardening assistance. So what are the expected outcomes? What we are looking for, it will ensure food security, not in form of food package, again I am mentioning, it will be providing food security to plants. The plants will also help in providing support to the other biodiversity. It will send them the enhancement, it will send them the, this project will help in sending the enhancement. It will also provide safe water supply for the people of Sundarban, those who will be directly benefited through pond restoration. We are looking at a beneficiary of 500 families with 2,000 plus people. Also, we'll be collecting 400 ponds.
Thank you, Nature Made Site. We have time only for this much right now. We'll start with the question and answers, questions from the dolphins.
Can you please enable your camera?
My camera, yes.
Would I go first? That's okay.
Yes.
Yeah, hi. No, this is interesting. I'm just curious. There's a lot of work that WWF has been doing in that area for years together in several of the islands. Are you in any way collaborating with that or building off that?
Yeah, we are working with them in places in the earlier years. We are actually a nature club formed out of WWF in our beginning when we are in our school days, nature club. That nature club is a WWF nature club. It was. Since 2006, we are working independently. As I mentioned, it's a landscape with 5 million people. So, you know, it's impossible for any individual NGO or entity to cover all the people. We are mostly working in Pasar Pothima and that side of Sundarban for this initiative, which is, you know, majority of the people are working who are working in the Sundarban Tiger Reserve area, because that's a more prominent area with more charismatic animals present. But we are working in a landscape where the biodiversity is enormous to reach, but relatively less focused, relatively less supported. So we have created a landscape which is fragile as all other places in Sundarban, but has relatively less attention so far.
All right. Thank you.
Fiona has a question.
Arjun,
yes.
Just want to thank you for doing this, because we really need to look after nature, and we really need to look after, you know, the biodiversity, which is so rich in India. And unfortunately, unless people go there, they don't realize its importance and value, right? So thanks for doing this. I just have a question. You did mention in the first slide, I think it was, that is it each family that gets about 5 fruit trees and vegetables? Okay, yes. So, and is this for sustenance, or is it for that they can actually use it as an economic?
Ma'am, we have selected the set of 5 trees, which include mango and jackfruit. Now, mango, you know, it gives you vegetable, it gives you a new source of nutrients while it's cooking. And then we have also the mango wood is much needed, you know, in our Hindu ritual, for cremation, mango wood is very much needed. So in village earlier days also, people used to have mango trees, which are used for, not only for supporting food, the source, but also for other rituals.
Okay.
Jackfruit leaves are very good fodder for animals. Jackfruit we take as vegetable and as fruit. And, you know, in a jackfruit tree, on an average, they get 50 to 60 jackfruit if they inform rice food or in form of vegetable, so they can sell some and they can eat some, and the wood, if if in the long run that he gets depleted by cyclone or other thing, jackfruit wood is also very good wood. It has a good timber value and it can help you make furniture. So we are keeping all those things in mind. Then we are
great.
Guava is very much needed because it gives you oral hygiene. Just simply chewing to fresh guava leaf, you can have a benefit which is very much needed in that landscape. Guava also supports other biodiversity, and guava is one of the best food to have around, and it goes well in Sundarbans. We have to keep that in mind as well, because it's a saline habitat. Not
exactly.
All of it goes well there. Okay. Then we are giving the citrus, which is party level, citrus lemon tree. It again supports many biodiversity, butterflies, birds, other things, and also gives you a constant source of vitamin C, which is very much needed to boost your immunity. And again, the amount of fruiting it has, you can sell a portion of it and you can earn some money out of it. And we are not giving it to earn money in that way, but it will reduce the pressure on your pocket for buying things, and it will help you earning some money. And the fifth thing is the banana tree. Now, banana leaf is one of the best things to have in your kitchen for your daily uses purpose. It reduces the pressure on your utensils, and it reduces the use of detergent to clean them, which is very much needed, because all the detergent we use, they get into the the river flow and ponds and other things, which actually kills many not so big looking things, but eventually has a very bad impact on all the biodiversity around.
Thank you. I have one more
question for him, please.
Sure. And then yeah, Arjuna has one, so it's
yeah.
Okay.
Just a very short question.
Sure.
Arjun,
sure.
You did mention about making people in the Sundarbans aware about plastic, etc. So what are you guys doing about that? Do you only make them aware, or is there any way in which you're like collecting that, or compacting it and taking it somewhere so that it can, because just making them aware is not going to stop them.
Absolutely. We are making them aware, and parallelly we are working with the forest department to ensure proper collection of them and proper disposal of them. We have involved the students also of 20 schools to gather all this plastic, not only from the school but from their family, and we are bringing it out of Sundarban.
Great. I'd love to connect with you on this.
Thank
yeah.
You.
Thanks.
So we have overshot the time, but we'll give the benefit of doubt to the technology, which wasted our time. But Arjuna, your question. You raise your hand.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks, Arjun, for sharing this. This is wonderful work being done on the ground. Just wanted to understand, there is the ecological, natural ecological diversity or the eco balance that you would look to maintain. And then there is the livelihood that you're also looking to sustain for the villages out there. So just wanted to understand the balance between how you're looking at it as a, a reclamation work versus saying, you're trying to ensure that no further damage happens to the ecosystem by giving them out. Like, how do you maintain that balance?
Actually, ma'am, if you look at the livelihood in Sundarbans, most of the people are living on fishes. They went into the forest to collect fish from the natural sources. And they are very much familiarly handling fish. So what we are trying to do is, we are trying to promote inland fisheries, which is much safer. They will not need to go to the forest, and the tiger attack and all these things will not happen. And as they are familiar with fish, as they know fishes very well, they can do very good with the inland fishery. So we are rectifying their ponds with experts, with certain things, so that the pond becomes very much productive. And from that pond, they can actually earn a sustainable amount of money throughout the year by doing inland fishery. And as we are doing a mangrove plantation is not just a simple plantation. Mangrove plantation acts as a hatchery, natural hatchery for fishes in the ecosystem. So if our plantation grows properly, then we will create natural fish hatchery in the river line. So it will enact as a, it will push the diversity of fish and abundance of fish in those areas, and eventually it will support the birds that it fishes, the reptiles that it fishes, and other things. So this is how we want to create the balance. And by providing food, you know, why they are going to forest? They are going to forest to earn money to buy food. So what we are doing is we are providing them certain elements of food which they can actually grow at their premises. And those things will also not only support them, they will also support the biodiversity. They will also act as a barrier during the cyclones and other things. So it's a win-win situation for both the parties. And what we are trying to do is plantation. By planting, we are selecting trees. We will give them food and support the local biodiversity, reduce their need to go out to the forest. And if they are not going out to the forest the way they are going out right now, then the forest will be benefited and there is a chance that it can regenerate itself.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So the viewers listening to Nature's Mate can also support them by the crowdfunding link, which is shared on Living My Promise Facebook page. Now can we also see what support the organization, support from the dolphins?
Can I go?
Yes, we are.
Okay. So Arjun, it's just wonderful that you're doing this and, you know, working in food securities. Our son currently is working in the Arctic Circle with the First Nation people in food securities itself. That's what his research is all about. And we are also very drawn to the cause, especially in India. And thank you for doing this, as I said before, and we'd like to support you with 5 lakhs.
Okay, so yes, I can go next. Is that okay?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I actually have my own selfish reasons as well. I do truly love nature, but I also see this as a way to offset the carbon footprint that we are putting down on Earth.
I want to mention one thing. Mangrove gives you blue carbon, which is very, very needed in need of the hour actually. So this transition will help in reducing the carbon footprint a lot.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so yeah, definitely one aspect of it is just offsetting the carbon footprint that we are living in the world. And the second, of course, is the balance that it's looking at building the livelihoods of the local residents out there, while also retaining the beauty of Sundarbans. And the last selfish reason, of course, is that it gives me more incentive to come to Sundarbans, which has been in my bucket list for a while. So with that, we would like to commit 2 lakhs for now. Yeah.
Anyone else wants to go?
Yeah, this is a space, you know, as professionally, we are quite active in. So we will certainly like to support you, and I've been in a dilemma whether to make a commitment now or take it to the CSR group at C-Kinetics and make them decide if this is one of the projects they would like to do it institutionally going forward. So I will make a commitment that we will at least commit 1.5 lakhs. But let me come back to you over the next 2-3 days. To see if this is something they would like to do. I visited quite a few places that you mentioned there. We tried to support some solar microgrids in that area as CSR funding a few years back. So quite keen to see what we can do there.
Thank you.
But good luck with your work.
Thank you.
Can you hear me now or no?
Yes, you.
Yeah, so lovely work that you do. And I think also I've discovered in the last 6 months, Sundarbans is the source of probably about 20 or 30% of girls who get trafficked. So what I would like to do is invest time with you and figure out areas of collaboration in various areas that will also help child trafficking. So I'll reserve the commitment for a later date, but I will inform Gunjan as to how much money will be committed. I'd really like to work through and ensure that both the environment and the women are taken care of. But great work there, Arjun. I've been there 20 years back, and for a change, the Indian side is much, much better than the Bangladeshi side. You will die out of a heart attack if you see the Bangladeshi side of the
I have not visited it yet, but I know that.
Not a single tiger there. They find Indians better, so they've all escaped the Indian side. The hats off to what you do.
Thank you.
So Sridhar, you did that survey as well.
Yeah. But the only good part of Bangladesh is trafficking doesn't happen here, but it happens a lot in the Indian side.
Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us, NatureSpeak, and all the best with the crowdfunding campaign that's live. So viewers watching us, if you like the work, you can support the organizations which have pitched through the day today. The crowdfunding campaigns will be live on our Facebook page. Thank you so much for joining in, all the participants, the dolphins, and our viewers today. We enjoyed hosting the show, and I'm sure you all enjoyed watching it. Thank you. And we have our next tank at 6 p.m. Do join us, where we'll have 5 such organizations waiting for your support. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Well, thank you.